Mi share the screen, please.
Before we start, Petros, if you give me 1 minute,
Yes,
I
yes.
wanted just to share a few info with the participants here on Zoom.
Okay.
So I mean, we've been repeating many times in this, in this introductory lecture, we are doing also, we are experimenting, let's say, this formula ourselves as well here at the ICCP. So we have seen that there are a lot of people following in streaming, and since they cannot interact, we will favor their question during the lecture. Okay? So, but you have an advantage here, and the advantage is that you have the Slack channels. So we encourage everybody that is attending and is selected to participate in the Zoom meeting to please use the Slack channel for any question. I mean, starting from now, during the lab where we expect to have the majority of the problems, but also during the lectures, if you use Slack, we have much more people there that are following the channels and that can reply to your questions. Okay? So if we want to try from now on that the people that are attending here in Zoom write their question on the Slack channel. So let's see how it works, and then we try to figure. Okay, Pietro, your stage is yours.
Okay. Okay, so greetings to everybody and sorry. Okay, greetings to everybody and welcome to this first hands-on session of the There is this annoying green line. Okay, never mind. Okay, greetings to everybody and welcome to this hands-on session, this first hands-on session. It will be the first one, so it will be mostly a warm-up for the next days. So we are trying to see how things works. I am Pietro De Lucas from SISA, and I will be presenting this hands-on. And other persons that will be tutoring you will be Anton Kokal, Shan-Mei Duan, Matiz Pobernitz, Umesh Mandal, Matteiush, and Yanin Kui. There will be the other tutors that will be available in the breakout rooms whenever you have issues and problems with any one of the exercises. Okay, the topic of the exercises of today are the first example will be the compilation of Quantum Espresso as the first example to show you how to compile the program. And then we'll be show you how to run some basic calculation using pw.x, that is the program that Ralph has just presented during the lecture of this morning. And then we will show how to use post-processing tools for plotting the molecular orbital density, charge densities with pp.x, how to compute density of states and plot it with dos.x, and then how to compute the band structure and plot it with and plot it. And okay, this is about the documentation of Quantum Espresso and how you can where you can download it. Ralph has already said many of these things during the lecture of before, so I will skip it. About the hands-on will be organized for those that are using the virtual machine. There will be organized. Oh, sorry, this stuff is. They will be organized in. For those using the virtual machine, the hands-on will be organized in days. So you will find the material of each of the hands-on in these directories, the one, the two, and so on and so forth. For those instead, I will be will be at will are not using the virtual machine, the exercises can be all found in this Git repository, that is on GitLab. This is the address of the GitLab repository. It's a little bit long, so I don't know whether you can read it or not, but it is available also on the ICTP web page, so you can take it from there. And okay. To do the exercises of day one, we just have, for those using the virtual machine, we have to go to the directory QI 2021 day one, or just from the virtual machine, you just from the virtual machine, you. Sorry. From the virtual machine, you just go to. Sorry, there is a bit of a mess with Zoom. And from the virtual machine, you just go to. You go to the desktop of. Go to the desktop of the virtual machine, you just go to select day one. And here on day one, you open a terminal in this way. And so you will be in day one directory. And so we start with the first exercise, that is example 01, query compilation. The exercise is pretty simple. You have just to, you will find in the directory the archive with the latest release of Quantum Express, so this file here. And you just have to extract it with. The tar command. After you have extracted the file, you just go into the directory. And okay. In the directory, you will also file called install.md that has all the instructions for compiling the code and configuring and compiling the code in most of the machines and for using most of the libraries that you want to link that. But today we'll keep things simple, and we'll use just the basic configuration, and using the virtual machine, we have everything that we need for compiling Quantum Express already installed in the virtual machine. So we just need to run the command configure, and the configure script will find all the needed libraries and all the needed configurations, and will write them in this file that is called make.inc. And you can check that the file has first of all found the MPI library and has found the FFTW library. And so the program will compile with with the MPI parallelism enabled and linking the FFTW3 library. Other things that you may check is the fact that the program has found the library, the BLAS LAPACK libraries installed inside the system. Otherwise, the program will try to compile the internal ones. That is usually not something that. Sorry, I will slow down. Yes, we'll find the libraries, the LAPACK and the BLAS libraries that can be found in the virtual machine. Otherwise, the program will try to compile LAPACK and BLAS libraries, and the compilation will take much more time. So we have now typed configure. I will retype it for who has not seen it. And running configure, the program finds all the instruction, all the settings. At this point, we just compile PW, and so the command for compiling PW is just make PW. You don't need to configure, you don't need to configure MPI because in this machine MPI is already been configured. So you don't need to configure anything. The program will find MPI already there. Usually, if MPI is installed in one of the standard paths where the autoconf script looks for it. You will find the program, the configure script will be able to find the MPI and use it automatically. So you will not, you don't have to enable that. There may be some cases when instead you want to avoid to compile the program with the MPI parallelism enabled, and so you have to instruct the program not to use MPI. And yes, okay. I think that we are using a system where MPI is already installed. But if you don't, obviously, installing MPI is a little bit more complicated, a little bit longer to explain, and during the exercise. And okay, there's no need to do the hands-on right now. I mean, I'm just showing you how to do the exercise, and then you will have time afterwards to do the exercise. And for any questions, please ask to the tutors that will be waiting for you in the breakout rooms. So more detailed questions about anything, about this compilation and about the other exercises will be explained afterwards by the tutors. Okay, so it's taking a little bit longer than usually because there is Zoom working on the machine, but I think it's going to end now. it's taking a little bit more time than usually because there is Zoom that is slowing down all the stuff, but it should be. Okay. So the program has finished, has compiled everything eventually, and you will find all the executables that have been compiled in the bin directory here. As you can see, these are links to the executables that are still in the source directory, and it has compiled not only pw.x, but it also compiled other programs that are tools that are used by users of Quantum Espresso, and okay, this is the first exercise. Then now we move to the actual exercises of computations, and there will be two exercises. There will be two other exercises that will be of actual compilation with Quantum Espresso. Let's see the first one. The first one is example1.binzine. Okay, I already ran it yesterday, so the directory is a little bit dirty. But so what we need to do here is to, we will find in the benzene directory already the input files for running the exercise. But whenever you want to write an input file of Quantum Espresso, you have to write a file like this. In the virtual machine, there are two tools that are very important, that are very helpful for writing an input file. One is the Emacs mode. One is the QI Emacs mode. So you open the file with Emacs, and inside Emacs you have activated the QI Emacs modes that allows you that have the automatic highlighting for the keywords of Quantum Espresso, and so you can see that everything is already set up. And in case you want to add you want to add any variable, you have also the possibility to add it directly, for example, using the shortcuts of the QI Emacs modes. Like, for example, for any variable, you can do like this. And then there is the auto-completion, so you can use the tab to auto-complete the command, and the Emacs will already tell you what is the right name of the variable, and it will ask you for the value of outdir. In this case, we don't want to set outdir actually, so we avoid to. Want to write it, but okay, it doesn't. I will put a variable for a value for that. Put this value. Okay, we don't want actually this value because we have already set up an input and default value, the default value for the outdir, so we don't want to use it. we go out. Another tool for editing the files, the input files of Quantum Espresso is the PW GUI utility. This is a this instead is a graphical user interface and allows you to open directly files, the input files like this. For example, you want to open the input file of Quantum of PW, and you open the file and the program reads the file, reads the settings in the file, and you can select directly the values with the instructions, and it's a little bit, maybe it's easier to use it than just than the editing directly the text. So you have a tab for each of the possible name lists of the input of Quantum Espresso of PW. So for example, you have control system and electrons, scions, and all the others. And okay, you can play around with them afterwards. Okay, the first exercise, so it consists on first, okay, you will find here the exercise consists first in running the self-consistent calculation for the benzene. So you just run like this. Okay. Sorry. And when the calculation is finished, you can look at the output of the program that is here. That the program check that the compilation that the run has terminated. At this point, okay, at this point you can run the post-processing utility pp.x in order to okay. At this point we run the post-processing utility. I will open it with PW GUI. We'll open the input file with PW GUI and show you. So you see you have the in the input file you have the name of the prefix. This is the same. The name of the prefix that is benzene, like it was for the self-consistent calculation. Then you have to specify the name of the output file that is in this case is psi square benzene, and then you have to choose the functionalities the post processing utility that you want to run. In this case, we want to run psi square, that is the utility that computes the charge density related to the to a single molecular Conician orbital, and so it computes in we are using the we are using the and so you just select this one here. And if we want, if we look directly at the file, we said we have we have the prefix specified as benzene. You have to specify the name of the plot of the file here. You have to choose the plot moon. This is the one that chooses you to do, that tells the program to compute psi square. Then obviously in this case we have we are doing a calculation only at gamma, so we have only one k point. We want to use all the orbitals, so we just go from the first to the 16th orbital and we select L sine equal true. L sine equal true means that as we are using, as we are running a molecule, we are running a molecule and we are then our Conician orbitals are real functions. So the only difference in the phase is due to the effect of the sign. So the program will not only compute the charge density related to the orbital, but will also give a the local value of the sign of the function in that point. And the point, and there are two namelists. One is input PP, where we tell the program what compute, and then we have another namelist that is called plot. Instead, tells the program how to print out the results. Here we have we specify the type of output that we want to use, that we want to have in output. So we have .xf means that the program will print out an output for xcrisden. If flag equal 3 means that we provide us with a three-dimensional data file. Then we have that we are going to plot only one file. Then here we specify the output format that is a 5 that is related to xcrisden. And okay, in this case, we have only one file, so we are not combining densities from many files, but in any case, you can, when you combine many files, then these files may be summed, and each file has an individual weight in the sum. In this case, having only one file, obviously, the sum is, the weight of the only one file is 1.0. Now we run the run pp.x. First, it computes the density, then it prints out in file. So the command, the instructions for running the exercise are here. I mean, if you miss any passage, just open the file. Called README. If you open it with Firefox, it's easier because it's formatted with a Markdown syntax, and so you can find here all the commands. So the first command is running pw. The second command is running pp.x. This is the one that I just typed, and it's pp.x. And then in input pp benzene, the input of the benzene calculation and. And just that, and then here are the other commands. And okay, at this point we have run pp.x, and we have produced the files with the charge density of each of the orbitals, and we have that. We have produced the files in two formats. One is the format that is internal to the post-processing utility, and it has its own format. And then we have also the format that is instead the one that we use to this one that will be used to plot the density files with xcrisden. So xcrisden is already installed in the virtual machine, so we just have to remember the syntax now as usual. We just run xcrisden. We run the command xcrisden in this way. So we say --xf is an option to specify the program that we are going to read. We're going to read an XS file, and so with the XS format. Okay, let me show you just briefly the XSF format in the terminal. So it's the file contains the information about the primitive cell of the structure, then the coordinates of the atoms, and then there are these data grids. Data grids are the data that we want that can be plotted. In this case, is the charge density of one orbital, and there are all the informations for reading and plotting it. So we just use the X-Crisden this way minus XSF. The program opens the structure, and first it just plots. The atoms, the structure of the atoms. Then at this point we want to see the we want to plot the data grid with the charge density. We go in tools, that is here. Okay, we have just here the various menus. We select the tools menu. We select data grid, and here in data grid we have we can select the different data grids. We have one only data grid, so we just select this one by default, and here there is a multiply factor. As the charge density is divided by the volume of the cell, so as the total charge is divided by the volume of the cell, it's printed in electrons per cell, and so it's very small because your cell is large, as your system is in this case we were computing an isolated molecule, so we're using a very large. A relatively large supercell where the graphene, you can see it here. We are using a supercell, so we have the benzene molecule that is at the center of a large supercell, and it's allegedly isolated by the periodic images that you can you can actually print if you want. If you want, you can show like this. You see, they are isolated one from the other, but they are one far away from the other. But in doing this, we are obviously using a very large supercell, so the value of the density is very small. So when we use tools and then data grid to import, okay, why not? Just when it doesn't work. When we import the data grid here, we need to avoid to have very small values. We can multiply this value for some multiplier. In this case, I use 100. So, and I just import it like this. And here the program shows you a menu where it tells you that here you have in this you see the you can see the oops wait on. So okay, here in this Okay, here, as you can see, here you have, you know, now I can see the top. Now you can see in the panel you have in the panel it shows you which is the minimum value of the charge density and the maximum values of the charge density. So you need to select a value between these two in order to show an iso surface. Just put here 0.3 just for trying, and we select here render iso value in order to have that the program also prints the sign of the charge density. We just submit, and as you can see, you have it plots you the charge density. One other thing that you can do is then you can try different values to see which is the one that it's better for you. So you see the. And then you can, after done this, you can customize the image. You can, for example, select a different color for the background, like for example, white. In this case, we don't need the supercell. So here in display, we can also select we can avoid to use the crystal to show the crystal cell. So if you select here, there, you can delete the crystal cell from there. Once the orientation of the crystal is when you have chosen a good orientation of the crystal, one other thing that you can do is select a tessellation factor that is better than 30 in order to have a better quality of the image. For example, we can use something like 70. And we can, other thing that we can do is just to select anti-aliasing to improve the quality of the image. Once we have done these things, one thing, as we have 16 orbitals here and we want to do the same customization of the image for all the orbitals, we can save the status of the molecule. We can save it in this file, in a file that is called, that we can call as we like. In this case, I will call it a MO state squeeze then, and then I will save it. Okay, the file already exists, but I just rewrite it. At this point, we can close this file, for example, and okay. For example, if we want to plot another orbital, for example, 12, using the same settings as before, you can use the option --- script and use the script that we have just saved like this, and the. The program just reads the instructions, uses the same settings that you were using before, and prints the file like this. And that's it. Okay, during the hands-on, you will also find here a script called plot psi-square.sh that allows you to plot and save all the images in the PNG format. If you want to learn more about how to use XCRISD, then it's a good thing to see how the example in this image. And just that. Now let's go to the second exercise, which is graphene. Before running graphene exercise, I changed some things in the exercise yesterday night. So please to download last settings, just do git pull like this. Okay, in my case, it says already up to date because I already saved the exercises there, but just do git pull to update everything in order to have the exercises as I'm going to describe you. Okay, also in this case, we have that we have various input files. The first input file is for the CF calculation. So you can see here the exercise, you can see here the input file. As I was saying before, you need to specify a prefix, you need to specify which type of calculation are you doing. And in principle, you have also to specify an outdir and a pseudo dir. Actually, in this case, we don't need to specify them just because they have been defined as environment variables. Virtual machine. So you have specified in the virtual machine two environment variables. One is espresso temp dir and espresso pseudo. Whenever we don't specify an input here in the input, the values of outdir and pseudodir, the program will look for these two environment variables and will set the outdir variable to espresso tempdir and the value of pseudodir to the value of espresso pseudo. So in calculations that are done in places where you have not set up these two variables, it's important that you specify here the value, the name of the outdir and of the pseudodir. So again, looking at the in system here, we have also the description of the system. The system is described by a IBRAV index that tells you which crystal structure you are using. In this case, IBRAV equal 4 means that we are using, for example, the hexagonal structure. And then these are the dimension of the structure, the number of the atoms, the number of types of atoms used in the cell. And here we are specifying the cutoff energy for the basis set and the cutoff energy for the density basis set. Other things that I can show you are here. We are here the coordinates of the atoms that we are using and the mesh of the key points that we are using. As you can see here, the hexagonal lattice constants have two main dimensions. The first dimension is the dimension of the lattice parameter on the plane, that is the length of, if you wish, of the hexagon. And then this one is the ratio between the height of the cell and the height of the cell and the in plane lattice parameter. As you can see here, it's put to three in order to assure, to warrant that we have enough distance between the graphene sheets and that they don't interact in order to simulate in this way a two-dimensional system using periodic boundary condition. This point we can run in pw.x. Yes. Okay. Calculation is very fast, just runs and prints out the output. Okay, after we have, there is a raised hand, please, can you, I don't know if it's possible. I think it's not.
Good morning, sir.
Yes.
I just have one question. We do the exercise on the same time, than you, or we do it?
No. It's, you can do also afterwards in the session, and just going to.
Thanks.
Yeah, there's no problem to. No. There is no need to follow me right now.
Thank you, sir.
And. Okay, once we have run the self-consistent calculation, we need to we will run a non-self-consistent calculation, and okay, the input for the non-self-consistent calculation is practically the same as the one for the self-consistent one. The only things that will be changing will be that here we'll be using NSCF instead of SCF. That means non-self-consistent calculation. And the other thing that is changing is that as we want to use this the eigenvalues computed in this calculation to compute the density of states and the density of states, we will use a denser mesh of key points. So it will be 12, 12, 1 instead of 9. And the other thing that we are going to change is the way in which we compute the occupations. If we look at the previous file, look at the previous file, you will see that occupation was not specified. So that means that occupations in that we use the fixed occupations, and we use fixed occupations, but instead, in this case, we are using tetrahedral occupation. Why we are using tetrahedral occupation? Because for computing the density of states, we need a more precise method to compute the occupations and the. And then you can see it will be different, and let's do that. So we now get that. Question is also very fast, and once we have computed the non-self-consistent calculation, you can use the DOS program. To compute the density of states of the system. The input of the DOS program is one. It's very simple. You just need to specify the prefix that has to be always the same as before. So that must be prefix equal graphene 1 × 1 PBE, and the name of the DOS file that you want to input that you want to print out in output, and you will read all the settings of the systems from the previous runs of from the previous PW runs. So the calculation is just DOS.x minus e DOS.graphene routine. And the program produces a file that is called graphene.dos. In graphene.dos, you will find two things. First thing that you have to notice that you have the value of the Fermi energy. And then you have the density of states. Then you have the density of states and the integrated density of states. This is the value of the density of states and this is the value of the integral of the density of states. This is the integral of the density of states. And for plotting it, we have prepared an input. We have prepared a script that is called dos.gp. Okay, the first thing that if you open the input, you will find that here you have 0.0. So you have to put here, instead of 0.0, you have to put here the value of the energy of the Fermi energy that you have found in the DOS file. Yes, the structure was already optimized. I think that we were using the experimental structure. I mean, this is not an example about how to optimize the structure. So we just took a structure that was already optimal and we just used it as an example. I mean, I don't know whether the value of the lattice constant is optimal. I guess it is, but I don't know. If you are curious about that, let me see. First, let's plot the DOS. So now, if you want to plot, you can just look at the pw.graphene.scf.out and if you're curious about if the structure was already optimized or not, one thing that you can do is take the input file of pw.x, the scf file, and here this flag tprn4 sent it to true. What the program does in this way is just to then we just rerun the program. Just rerun the program, and at the end of the program, you will have that. Of course, it's printed out, but actually, the point is that in this case, the system obviously is symmetric, so the forces are vanishing by default. So you need to optimize the lattice constant in this case. And obviously I don't know whether it was optimized or not. And so the other thing that you can do is to try to optimize, to check a different lattice constant and see what happens. But this is an example that we'll do tomorrow with other systems, but then you can obviously adapt them to graphene. And, okay, now just we want just to plot the DOS. We have prepared the script, and so now we plot just the script like this. And the program print shows you the output, shows you the DOS. So the part that is filled is the part up to the Fermi energy. The part that is remains unfilled is instead for the valence bands that are not filled. We have set out let me show you again the the plotting script makes two things. First thing to the the plotting script does two things. The first thing that the plotting script does is to shift the energy values in order that they are that the zero is at Fermi energy. And just that. So in this case, when you when you see the plot, you see that you see that the Fermi energy is set at zero equally. Well, instead, okay, this is obviously in the we find that the value of the Fermi energy that you had in the at the end of the DOS file was 0.92. So we are just shifting the energy in order for plotting density of states with the Fermi energy at zero. Okay, and the second part of the exercise is plotting the bands of graphene. So now we have to run another W calculation. In this case, we see select as calculation bands. The input is always the same because the program must read the density of the charge density from the same file as before. In this case, we don't specify occupations because we are computing the bands, but we specify the number of bands because by default, the program uses as occupation fixed, but when you use fixed as occupation, only the occupied bands are computed. And if we want to compute also the valence, the conduction bands of the of graphene, we need to specify more bands than the four bands that are occupied in graphene. So we now run the calculation. Also, this calculation is very fast. And then we run another post-processing utility that is called bands.x. And use the input that is already being prepared. Also, this input is very, very simple. It just contains, again, the prefix that is important because you need to in the prefix because it's it instructs the program where to read all the data from PW. Then you have to specify the number of the file that you want to write. And here we also specify lsim equal to, that means that the program will, that bands.x will make the symmetry analysis of the bands. Just run bands.x. And again, you see we have specified lsim equal true, and identified, and so the program makes the symmetry analysis at each point, so it prints you the symmetry analysis of all the eigenvalues of the bands that you have computed. And if you are looking for something that is symmetry related, this is the file that you have to look. At this point, we have we want to plot the bands. To plot the bands, we have created another new plot script that is called spaghetti.gp. Again, here in the file that you have in your directory, this value is still set to zero, and you have to set it to the same value of the Fermi energy that you will find in the DOS file. Then you have to uncomment this line that here is already uncommented, that will set the plot the zero axis in order to show you where the Fermi energy is, and then the script runs. The script just reads the file called graphene.bands.data.gnu and just takes the values, shifts them of the Fermi energy in order that the Fermi energy is plotted at zero, and plots everything like this. And we have also set here the ticks to the high symmetry points in the Brillouin zone. You need just to run it and like this. And here you have your bands, and you can see here there is the Dirac point, and this is the exercise, and that's it. And okay, there is one more thing that I wanted to say. And in this case, the path of the we'll show you the slide directly, it's better. Okay, there are two tools for creating the Brillouin zone that I wanted to talk to you. I mean, in this case, the plot of the Brillouin, the key points for the path for the band plot were already set in the input, so you don't have to create it. But there are two tools for creating it. One is the key path selection tool of Mixcrisden, and the other one is one that you can find online in materialscloud.org tools seek path. And that also allows you to create a path. This tool suggests you a path that is the path that is usually used as a standard, and then gives you the coordinate and helps you to write the input file. And I think that's it. Sorry if it was a little bit confusing the presentation. It's just that I had a problem with sharing the screen, and I almost couldn't see anything of what I was presenting. So I'm sorry. If there are any questions, otherwise.
There are several questions from the streaming. If you can look them in the chat, I posted it for you.
Okay. OK, Okay, yes, 0.920. Okay, the first question is, yes, you need to do the NSCF before doing the DOS.x on or Proj.x. Okay, it's not mandatory. You can also use the eigenvalues that you have computed with the self-consistent calculation. But usually when you do the self-consistent calculation, you use a key point mesh that is good for doing an accurate self-consistent calculation. But then when you want to plot the DOS, for the quality of the DOS, you may need a finer mesh. The other thing is that, for example, in this case, for doing the density of states of the projected density of states, we want to use the tetrahedral method. Why we want to use the tetrahedral method? Because, well, the CF calculation just tries to compute accurately various integrals in the Brillouin zone. When you are plotting a density of states, you are actually plotting all your functions are much more much sharper, so they will require a much more denser number of key points, and also techniques like the smearing technique or just the thin sum with the Moncos pack are not accurate enough, because they just try to take away the integration of the periodic part of, for example, in this case of your eigenvalues. In the other case, instead, you have something that is much more localized in values. So, for example, when you do a density of states, you have the calculation of your band times. Times a step function that is very, very sharp and cannot be done accurately with the other techniques. So yes, in principle, you can use directly the SCF, but the result that you get is qualitatively not the same. It's not so good. So it's always better to have first a non-self-consistent calculation and then a non-self-consistent one. It says it's better to use IBRAV. Let me see, but I don't understand why it's okay. Every time I run the code, it says it's better to use IBRAV. Yes, it's true, and because when you specify an IBRAV vector, then what happens is that the lattice is generated by Quantum Espresso itself. So all the symmetry analysis is made easier, and it's a little bit it's more protected, it's safer. While instead, when you use IBRAV equals zero, what happens is that you have to specify the lattice vectors, and then it all depends on how many digits you are using in specifying the lattice vectors. It depends on how if the orientation of these lattice vectors is compatible with the symmetry analysis of PW. It should be, but as orientations are infinite, we actually never know exactly what may happen, and especially when you run first a calculation with PW and then you want to use this information to run a final calculation, it's much more safer if you specify the IBRAV, if you have an IBRAV that is correctly done. I mean, sometimes one needs to specify instead the lattice vectors, then you can also use those ones and just take the warning, and if you know what you are doing, it's also okay not to use IBRAV. Then, so the structure was not already optimized. Okay, this one has already answered. So yes, how should we decide if to describe the structure using IBRAV equals zero or specifying the IBRAV? Okay. No, in the case of graphene, as I showed you, there is no need to do the relax calculation because by symmetry the forces are zero. What you may need to do is to compute to check that the lattice constant is the one that minimizes the structure. But okay, this was not the scope of the exercise. In this case, the exercise we just took a value of the lattice constant that is close to the experimental one, and with this one we just wanted to show you how to compute the density of states and the bands. Yes, in principle, obviously you may want to use an optimized lattice constant, even if in many cases, when you are computing quantities that depend on the lattice constant, in many cases, if the DFT doesn't give you a very accurate value of the lattice constant, it may also be useful to use directly the experimental lattice constant. Also, in this case, is something that depends from case to case, and one has to. If he knows what he's doing, he can decide by himself. Then okay, as I was saying, here there is another question. In PWSCF data out, we found 0.9202 for the density of states, and instead when we do graphene DOS file, we find 0.9207. Okay, the difference is not that large in this case, but as I was saying, we were using two different techniques to compute the density of states and two different key point mesh. The most accurate is the key point mesh. The most accurate is the value of the of the Fermi level. And so yes, there is some slight change. And so the most accurate you are, the better it is, even if in this case, the difference is very small, 0.9202 and 0.9207, that are practically the same. Okay, so there are other questions in the Slack channel that I still haven't opened. And yes, you can do a spin component projected band structure plot. We will show something like this in the day of magnetism, actually. So we will it will be a day 7. So you have just to wait. I mean, if you are very curious, you can also go directly to the exercises in day 7 and see how it's done there. And otherwise, just wait for the tutorial that day. And what else? Okay, sorry, the Slack is taking some time to open. It takes a long time to open. Why? I don't understand. Okay, day 1. Okay, you don't. There are a lot of questions in the. Okay, sorry, I shouldn't have. Actually, yes, it's. really a lot of questions.
Pietro, but you don't need to do the Slack answer from here. I mean,
okay. We'll try to answer the question afterwards.
Yeah, we do it.
Okay, just start doing the exercise because I've run very late and I was a little bit too long about what I mean. Yesterday I tried the presentation, it was much, much faster. And today instead it was a kind of complete confusion, sorry. So I think that you can start doing the calculation. I will try to answer the questions in Slack now. And I think it's, I can stop sharing the screen now. And and yes, okay. I think it's everything for now.
Yeah, if somebody lost most of the steps or some like generic trouble, they can join the breakout room with the
tutors.
Like a one-to-one help.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I will start answering the question on the Slack now and
yeah, if there are no, yeah, we can close the
session. Okay.
No, not the session. We can close the the streaming session. We can remain available here for the people in Zoom.
Okay.